Good morning, First Covenant Church, and welcome to our Sunday morning service. Whether you're joining us live in the worship center or online, we're so glad that you chose to worship with us this morning. For those of you joining us through the live stream, please subscribe to our channel on YouTube so that you can receive a notification when we start the service each week. Just click subscribe and choose the notifications you'd like to receive. My name is Stephanie Carlson, and I am the Children and Family Ministry Director here at First Covenant Church. My family and I have been worshiping at First Covenant for 5 years, and I had the privilege to serve this congregation both in the main office and most recently as the Children and Family Ministry Director. I love the opportunity to inspire, equip, and support families to grow together in relationship with each other and Jesus. Please take time now to connect with us. Let us know that you're here, and we encourage you to share your praises and prayer requests. Our staff and elders love praying for you every week. If you're not sure where to go to connect with First Covenant Church, check out the following screen. There are many ways that we can support local ministry in and through First Covenant Church. Your tithes and offerings help to grow God's kingdom around the world too. Check out the next screen for giving details. Take out your calendars, because here comes an announcement about our upcoming Good Friday service. We will be gathering here in the Worship Center at 7 p.m. that Friday, April 2nd. So please join us as we prepare for the good news of what is to come. After the service today, please take your conversations out to the parking lot. And if you stay indoors, be sure that you're out of the flow of traffic so that people can move freely to exit the building. Over the past two Sundays, we have been looking at what it means to be a gospel-centered disciple of Jesus Christ. Simply put, a gospel-centered disciple is someone who learns the gospel, relates in the gospel, and communicates the gospel. This morning, we are unpacking what it means to relate in the gospel, specifically how disciples of Jesus connect to God and interact with one another because of the gospel. In today's message, listen for how we so often give up our legitimate identity in Christ by going down the road of legalism or license. But there's good news. We have three powerful motivators to remain gospel-centered in how to relate to God and to one another. So take a breath, settle your mind, and open your heart. There might be some hard truths for you to wrestle with this morning. Maybe this past week has been a hard week for you and you're feeling overwhelmed or overrun. Take heart. God's grace is immense, immeasurable, and immovable. You are in the right place. Looks like we're ready to start the service. Have a great Sunday.
Invitation to worship. It will be from Psalm 136, and I'll read a verse, and then you will respond with, "His love endures forever." So let's try that. I'll raise my arm, and you'll say, "His love endures forever." Perfect. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His love endures forever.
Give thanks to the Lord, the God of gods. Give thanks to the Lord of lords. To him who alone does great wonders. Who by his understanding made the heavens. Who spread out the earth upon the waters. Who made great the lights. The sun to govern the day,
His love endures forever.
The moon and stars to govern the night.
His love endures forever.
And with that, let's sing to the Lord our opening song, "My Feet Are on the Rock."
I can can see the clouds rolling. I can feel the winds, they try to shake me. I will not be moved. My feet are on the rock. Ooh, I can feel the waters rise. I can hear the howling lies, they haunt me. Fear won't hold me now. My feet are on the rock. The joy on the horizon. Here my faith is found. I stand on solid ground.
I feel my hope about to break. I will cling to your unchanging grace.
Let the waters come and the earth give way.
I'll be dancing in the rain.
On the rock. Ooh. I'm Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock. I'm Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock.
When I feel my world about to break, I will cling to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come and the earth give way, I'll be dancing in the rain.
When I feel my
brothers and sisters, will you please be seated as we watch our Lent video of Psalm 119, verses 9 through 16. This morning, and we're sorry. We are sorry, Lord, for putting ourselves first this week and not you. We're sorry for thinking things, Lord, that maybe weren't from you or of you. And God, we rejoice in knowing that you created us for a purpose, Lord, and you created us to praise you, to worship you, and to know you. And God, and I thank you for the opportunity to gather here this morning at First Covenant Church as a body of believers
to learn more of how to be a disciple of the gospel and to relate in the gospel, Lord. And Lord, we ask for courage to communicate the gospel to those who don't know it, to those who maybe just don't believe it. But Lord, we ask that you just equip us to serve you. And God, I also recognize that maybe last week for some of us sitting in this room was the first time, Lord, that we truly learned what is the gospel. And God, I ask that you just meet us where we're at. Meet us where we're at, Lord, and we know that you do, so that we can live deeper lives rooted in you, rooted in your truth, and praising you with every ounce of our being, Lord. And I ask that you be with Pastor Chris as he continues us in this journey of what it means to be a gospel-centered disciple. Lord, I pray that you give us ears to hear it. I pray that maybe it challenges us in a way that challenges things that we've thought from our whole lives. And we're hearing something new or something different in a way, Lord, that that maybe just makes us dig deeper into what it is that you're trying to teach us. And Lord, let us be okay with that. Let us be humbled by that. And Lord, I thank you. I thank you for this morning, and I thank you for the opportunity to worship you with this body of believers. Lord, we love you. Help us love you more. Amen.
Well, thank you, musicians who have helped lead us and get us started this morning in our worship. Thank you, congregation, for your singing. I love that song. It just kind of gets me going in the morning. I'm not much of a dancer, but, you know, I shuffle my feet here in the front row a little bit, and so it's good to be together today in worship, hearing and receiving, responding to the Word of God. We are in a series, as Stephanie mentioned, entitled Gospel-Centered Discipleship. And we began this series by exploring what we mean. We have to define these terms. And gospel is simply the good news. The good news that Jesus Christ has atoned or covered up our sin. And we are made right through his sacrifice. And then we learned, well, what is a disciple? A disciple of Jesus Christ, then, is somebody who, you can do it with me now, get your hands ready, learns the gospel, relates in the gospel, and communicates the gospel. Very good. Christian discipleship is a lifestyle that is solidly rooted in growing out of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let me say that again. Christian discipleship is a lifestyle that is solidly rooted and growing out of the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's important. Gospel-centered disciples keep their eyes on Jesus because the one that we look at, you begin to look like. The one you look at, you begin to look like. And when we look like Jesus, this shapes how we relate. We relate to one another in the good news. Believe it or not, the gospel changes how we interact and how we relate one to another, how we relate with unbelievers in the world around us, and most importantly, how we relate to an almighty God. The gospel is meant to change how we relate. Christians truly relate in this world differently than any other group or identifying factor of humanity. That should be a hallmark of the Christian church, of a follower of Jesus. People should be able to see that. It should be a neon sign that says, I'm a Jesus follower, solely based on the fact that we relate to the people around us, believers and non-believers alike, in a way that's completely different than anybody else in our world and in our culture. This is what it means to be relating in the gospel. We no longer relate as those who are cursed in the Garden of Eden, but as benefactors of the Garden of Gethsemane. If you don't know what I'm talking about, I encourage you to go to YouTube and check out last week's sermon. This is what we are discussing, gospel-centered discipleship. And why are we discussing this? I have come to realize that if we are not purposeful in our fight to remain centered in the gospel, then we begin to function out of our natural human nature, which is our sinful human nature. And we begin to function in relating with one another, relating with the Almighty God, and relating with the rest of the world. We err in really two significant ways. First, we drift from the true message of the gospel of Jesus into legalism. We fabricate a gospel of our own works that becomes a counterfeit for the real truth of the gospel. We become, as Jesus describes the Pharisees, whitewashed tombs. We look good on the outside, but inside, we're dead. Second, we dilute the gospel, using God's grace as a license to remain in our sin. We water down the gospel, taking away its potency for transformation. The result is that we lose gospel power. We neglect the Holy Spirit and ultimately suffer from spiritual malnutrition. This isn't new life in Christ. It's a watered-down religious cocktail. In Matthew 25, Jesus gives an analogy concerning our final judgment, in which he separates, the good shepherd, separates the sheep from the goats. And in his explanation of the analogy, the king, sitting in judgment, tells the sheep that their devotion to him, expressed through their serving other people, primarily the hungry, the thirsty, the naked, the sick, the imprisoned, that their serving them is now being rewarded. And the king says to them, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the creation of the world." Now, if you know the passage, you remember that the goats, on the other hand, were sent away, having squandered their devotion to Christ. And I share this with us this morning because I think that as a disciple of Jesus, all of us want to hear those words. Come, inherit the kingdom prepared for you. We long for those words. Like the good servant just preceding this passage, we look forward to hearing the affirmation, "Well done, good and faithful servants." But I invite you to imagine with me. Imagine that after the king gives this pronouncement, that he leans forward in his throne. He looks you directly in the eye, and he says, "So why did you do it? Why did you do it? Why did you follow me? What is your motivation?" Now, Jesus isn't going to ask us that question because Jesus knows our heart. But do we? Do you? Do you really know why you're following Jesus? Church, this is an essential question, and I feel too often we glaze right over it. Our motivations actually are very, very important. Your motivation matters in your discipleship because motivation deals with your heart. Why are we disciples of Jesus? Is your discipleship actually legitimate? Does it flow from an authentic identity firmly established in the gospel of Jesus Christ? Our motives matter because they reveal our hearts. This morning we will be looking at two illegitimate approaches that keep us from being gospel-centered disciples. They are legalism and license. And then I'm going to wrap up by exploring three overlapping motivating factors which flow directly from the gospel and serve to keep us legitimately centered in the gospel of Jesus Christ. These are bedrock, foundational, motivating factors that are found throughout Scripture. Finally, I'm borrowing these principles directly from Jonathan Dodson's book, Discipled-Centered Leadership. I tried so many different ways to rewrite his words and make them more my own. I couldn't do it. His chapters here expressing this are excellent. And so all credit to Jonathan Dodson, the work he has done in here, and I am going to try to lead us today in unpacking this a little bit more. The gospel writer John sent an accompanying letter with his account to help early Christians understand what is revealed in the gospel that he wrote. In it, John unpacks for us what it means to relate in the gospel. In fact, I would argue that the letter of 1 John in the New Testament is all about relating in the gospel. That is the overwhelming focus of 1 John. And right away in 1 John chapter 1, the author addresses the deadly traps of legalism and license, which get in the way of our gospel-centered discipleship. So if you have your Bibles, you want to follow on your phone, I believe it'll also be up on the screen. But let's turn to 1 John chapter 1, beginning with verse 5. This is the message we have heard from him and declare to you. God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not live out the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us from all sin. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sin, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. If we claim we have not sinned, we make him out to be a liar, and his word is not in us. My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world. In his opening chapter, John is making it crystal clear, God is all light, and in him there is no darkness. We relate with one another and with God as those who are purified by the blood of Jesus. John goes on to point out that, you know, your sin matters. Sin is a problem. And if we think it's not, we're deceiving ourselves. Sin is a problem, and it matters. But, he said, if you confess your sin, God is faithful to forgive because we are purified by the blood of Jesus. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sin. There isn't even a hint in John's writing that somehow disciples of Jesus can carve out a righteousness for themselves separate from the blood of Jesus. But let's be honest. That doesn't stop us from trying, does it? We try to earn it. We try to do it on our own. So let's start with the first trap, the trap of legalism. Legalism is simply the tendency in the human heart to measure our worth by how well we perform. Legalism is that tendency in the human heart to measure our worth based on how well we perform. In our discipleship in the Christian church over the past many decades, we felt the best way to make disciples was to put them under a matured Jesus follower who could teach them biblical right from wrong. In essence, we wanted to put people in a room together so we could teach them how to perform biblically, how to perform Christianly. The better your performance, the more like Jesus you're becoming. We used method and even words like accountability to ensure that someone else was helping you police your actions, overcome your wickedness, and enhance your religious performance. That's what accountability was. Somebody that you can open up to, that's going to hold your feet to the fire, that's going to be there to keep you on the right track. This is a dangerous kind of legalism. And it can be legalism can be performed spiritually. And in accountability, we ask each other, how often do you pray? How much do you read your Bible? How many times do you go to church this month? Did you volunteer enough at church this month? Legalism can also be performed missionally. How many people did you share the gospel with? Did you perform any acts of compassion, mercy, or justice? Did I serve the poor enough? Legalism is expressed and can be performed morally. Did you gossip this week? Did you view any pornography? Did you cheat on a test? Did you lie? How many good deeds did you perform? See, it's all about what did I do and what didn't I do? And on one hand, these are good questions because they help me reflect on the character of Christ that is in me. But as more often is the case, the motivation becomes to perform for God better this week than I did the week before. And when I perform well, then I feel great about myself. And when I perform poorly, then I feel bad about myself. And the problem is there is absolutely no way that I can perform my way into God's good grace. Amen? I can't earn it. Doesn't matter how good my works are, they're still filthy rags compared to the goodness, holiness of God. The only one I'm deceiving is myself. I can't perform my way into God's good grace. And to make legalism even more disastrous, some of us recognize that we can't perform our way into God's good grace, so we don't even really try. Instead, our legalism is meant to impress the people sitting around you. I know I can't impress God, but at least I can impress the rest of my church. That's even a more disastrous expression of legalism. We settle on a performance for one another. I can't make myself righteous in the eyes of God. At least I'll look good in front of my church. At its core, legalism is the attempt to live sinlessly through my own efforts and acts of self-righteousness. Legalism is an attempt to elevate myself above my ugly sin nature in order to look good in my own eyes, in God's eyes, and in the eyes of others. But John writes to us in this opening letter, if we claim to be without sin, we lie to ourselves, and the truth is not in us. He goes on in verse 10, if we claim we have not sinned, we make God out to be a liar, and his word is not in us. Think about that with legalism. You're not only deceiving yourself, you're saying God is a liar. But John also unpacks for us the truth, the authentic, the legitimate, gospel-centered antidote right in the middle of verse 9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. How is this even possible? We have our advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sin. Legalism is so dangerous to discipleship because through it we replace the lordship of Jesus with an idol of ourself. Think about that for a moment. Legalism replaces the lordship of Jesus with nothing more than an ugly idol of ourselves. We replace Jesus' perfect performance with our own imperfect performance. Religious performance deceives us by saying, impress God and he will approve you. But the gospel reminds us that our approval before God is not based on our performance, but on the performance of Jesus in his perfect life, death, and resurrection. Amen? The Son has impressed the Father on your behalf. That's the good news. The Son has impressed the Father on your behalf. Discipleship focused on legalism is a poor substitute for legitimate, gospel-centered discipleship focused on Jesus. Legalism takes us away from the gospel center, makes it about ourselves, and we deny the lordship of Jesus. It's a faulty discipleship. It's a trap. Even saying that, I'm a Star Wars fan, right? My boys, probably, if they were listening, the same thing. I think of Admiral Akbar and the destruction of the second Death Star. It's a trap! Legalism, it's a trap! Okay. If legalism is the attempt to follow the rules, spiritual license is freedom from the rules. Because God has forgiven me, that means I'm free to disobey. So if legalism is one side of the extreme, spiritual license is the other. And this is exactly what the Apostle Paul addresses in Romans chapter 6. If God's grace increases in the face of sin, should we just go on sinning all the more? And Paul says, absolutely not. It's not an excuse to just go out and sin more. You don't get spiritual license from the gospel. But spiritual license is dangerous because it only acknowledges half of the salvation reality of Jesus Christ. Spiritual license rightly acknowledges we are free from sin, that is true, but forgets that we are freed into a life of obedience. Spiritual license deceives us by saying, because God has forgiven me, I'm free to disobey. But the truth of the gospel is, because I'm forgiven in Christ, I'm bound to obey. That's the gospel center. License just says, now you're free, go do what you want. We forget that we are bound in Christ Jesus. I'm bound to obey. Again, turning to John's letter. If we claim to have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not live out the truth. That's what John's saying. If you claim to have fellowship with God through the blood of Jesus Christ and yet you go on continuing in your sin, you're in the darkness. There's no light in you. Spiritual license effectively deludes us into believing that our sin doesn't really matter. I claim to be saved, yet I walk in darkness unchanged. We misinterpret God's forgiveness for a kind of divine apathy. We wrongly believe that our sin doesn't matter, that God just doesn't care. That's wrong. And when we believe that, then all of a sudden there's no need for repentance. And confession becomes little more than a balm over our guilty conscience. Spiritual license doesn't elevate God's grace and forgiveness. It, in fact, devalues it. John continues in verse 7, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his Son, purifies us from all sin. There it is. There it is. Relating in the gospel. We relate to one another with the holy God in the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ. The gospel, the good news, the work of Jesus, not our own, must remain the center of our discipleship, which impacts how we relate to one another. Amazing grace is amazing because we see it through the lens of our sinfulness. Amazing grace is only amazing because we see it through the lens of our sinfulness. Take away the sin. What's so amazing about the grace? I didn't even want it. Both legalism and license fail in growing and shaping Christian disciples. And I will be so bold as to say, if you have been on a course over the course of your life where you are struggling in your faith formation, where you're struggling to follow Jesus, where you find yourself slipping again and again back into the ways of this world, I will be so bold as to say, perhaps you have been trying to grow your relationship with Jesus out of the infertile soil of legalism or the infertile soil of spiritual license. You can't grow. There's no nutrients in that soil. Legalism makes performance the criteria for relating. License makes personal freedom and tolerance the criteria for relating. Both fall short and I believe have led to people ultimately walking away from the church and saying this is nothing but a lie, nothing but a sham. So those are the imperfect, those are the illegitimate ways of relating to one another in the church. Relating to one another, relating to the world, relating to God. These are imperfect ways. So what are the legitimate ways? How do I legitimately stay centered in the gospel? I'm going to give us three motivating factors to remain centered in the gospel. Number one, Christian affection. Psalm 37:4 says, "Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart." Philippians 4 says, "Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say it, rejoice." Jesus tells his disciples in John 15 to obey him motivated by love. Or Psalm 34, "Taste and see the Lord is good." God's love is meant to be experienced in people's lives through faith. Christian affection is a gospel-centered motivation because it is an affection for God that arises from the new creation of God. Believe it or not, it is possible to love God, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, and all your strength. That it is the affection for the Almighty God that actually dictates, that actually stimulates, that actually draws you out of yourself and into the glorious center of the good news. It's an affection for God. As Pastor John Piper writes, "God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in him. God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in him." Gospel-motivated disciples obey God because it makes them truly happy. I open this sermon with the imaginary question, why did you do it? Imagine Jesus asks us that question, why did you do it? Why did you follow me? A gospel-motivated disciple will look Jesus back in the eye and respond, "It was my pleasure. It was my joy to follow you. I couldn't help it. That was where the delight of my heart rested, was to be with you. That's why I did it, because I loved you, recognizing how much you first loved me. It was my pleasure to do so." Because we too often fall out of Christian affection, the second motivating factor is an awareness to God's warnings and promises. David writes in Psalm 19, "By your decrees, your servant is warned. In keeping them, there is great reward." David recognizes, by your warnings, I can understand, I see, and there's great reward in keeping. There's promise in keeping your word. God has given us the law so that we would be able to recognize our sin. Spiritual license isn't the path of a Jesus disciple because sin destroys. Ignoring it or excusing it away does not weaken the destruction. It becomes, in fact, that much more tragic. God warns us the wages of your sin is death, but the gift is eternal life, warnings and promises. The gospel proclaims God did not abandon you in your sin, but redeemed you from it. The warnings have not been lifted, but there is a promise delivered right in the middle of our sin hurricane. Peter would write to the church, "Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God that he may exalt you at the proper time." Warnings and promises. Over and over again throughout the scriptures, we see God's warning against sin and idolatry paired with God's promise of forgiveness and eternal life. We do not follow an angry, vindictive God, but instead a loving Heavenly Father who disciplines us because He wants to draw us into the center of His affection for you and me, and for us to respond in affection towards Him. That's the whole Old Testament. We get in there and say, why is God so mean to these people? Because they chose to walk away from God. And rather than abandoning them, God honors His commitment to them by drawing them back in, by disciplining them as a loving Heavenly Father. And the Apostle Paul reminds us all the promises of God are yes and amen in Jesus. How do we respond? How do we access the promise? That is, in fact, the third motivating factor. We unwrap the gift of repentance. Now, this is not a one-time act, but a new way of life. Let that sink in. Repentance is not a one-time act, but a new way of life. Gospel-motivated, gospel-centered discipleship is a gift wrapped. It's a gift-wrapped grace from God, and it is torn open through repentance. Martin Luther would write, "The entire life of believers is to be one of repentance." Well, that sounds horrible, doesn't it? Who wants to spend... We walk away around our, through our lives constantly beating ourselves over the back. God, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Is that what Luther is suggesting? Our entire lives is to be one of repentance? But I think we get this wrong. We confuse feeling guilty with repentance. And we do this because we fail to appreciate the authentic gift of the gospel. We fail to recognize that we are accepted because of Christ's sacrifice. The curses of the Garden of Eden have been swallowed up by the perfection of the Son in the Garden of Gethsemane. Repentance, church, is not a punishment. Repentance is a gift. It is our second chance. It's new life from the ashes of the old. Paul writes to the Romans, God's kindness is intended to lead you into repentance. Repentance is faith. That's what Luther is saying. Faith in God is a life of repentance. UK pastor and theologian Tim Chester writes, "Turning to God in faith and from sin in repentance are in fact the same movement." Turning to God in faith and away from sin in repentance are the same movement. You cannot turn to God in faith without turning away from sin in repentance. So if we imagine that God is over here, off to my right, your left, but I begin to walk away in this direction, but I feel that tug on my heart, I recognize I'm moving away from God, I'm entering into sin, I'm in sin. You see, I cannot put my faith in God without repentance. I can't face God and move towards God without first turning away. It's the same thing. Putting my faith in God means that I'm repenting, turning away from putting faith in sin. They are, in fact, the same movements. Tim Keller adds that a repenting Christian is, in fact, a growing Christian. Well, we like to think that a mature Christian, they don't even need to repent. Because they got it all figured out, right? They're perfect. No. A growing Christian is going deeper with Jesus. Deeper with Jesus. We begin to unpack layers of our sinful nature we didn't even realize we had. And we experience the same grace, the same gift of forgiveness, the same freedom through repentance, the same love of the Father. With each and every layer, our affection for God deepens and increases. A growing Christian is a repenting Christian because the grace of God is working deeper and deeper into your life. all of life repentance is the best sign that we are growing deeply and rapidly into the character of Jesus. And so all of these motivating factors work together to keep you and I relating in the gospel. Christian affection motivates belief in God's warnings and promises, which in turn motivates a life of repentance when we fail to be motivated by the foundational joy in Christ. It just works in that cycle. This is how we remain centered in the gospel. This isn't about trying to graduate from this cycle. It's about remaining in it and going deeper with Jesus. And it is none other than the Holy Spirit who guides and motivates us to go deeper in Christ. The Spirit is the motivation behind the motivation. When I say that a disciple is a follower of Jesus who relates in the gospel, this is what I'm suggesting. That we are people who are committed to going deeper in Jesus through these legitimate practices of who we are. Not the illegitimate ones of license, spiritual license, or legalism. This is about abiding with Christ Jesus in his transforming work in your life. Relating to God in faith through repentance and relating to one another as people of the light. And in this, our motives matter. Each of you is motivated to come here this morning. If you're following us online, you are motivated to get out of bed and turn on the YouTube channel to follow us online. Each of us is motivated by something. Why are you doing it? Your motives matter. Motives matter. Why are you walking with Jesus? Why do you do it? So often we get wrapped up in the what or the how or the when, but what if the Lord is most concerned about the why? What if Jesus wants to know why? Truth is, he already knows why. Do you? Our motives matter. If you're here this morning because it's just what good Christians do, I encourage you to check your motives. If you're here to get your worship in for the week or achieve heaven points, I would encourage you, check your motives. Why do you do it? Gospel-centered disciples learn the gospel, to be sure, but we also relate in the gospel. It is why we live for Jesus. The why is found in how we relate in the gospel. Christian affection, awareness of God's warnings and promises, and unwrapping God's gift of repentance, which is turning to faith in Christ Jesus. Remain rooted in the center of the gospel. Let's pray together. Father God, we come together this day with thankful hearts. God, we cannot read this text, we cannot immerse ourselves in the gospel without being a people of grateful hearts. Lord, I've said it before and I believe it, even if you did nothing else for us for the rest of our lives individually, as a church, within our culture, if you did nothing else for us, you have already done more for us than we ever deserved. And for that, we are so thankful. All praise to you, God. We are grateful for your gift of salvation. Thank you, God. Thank you. We also, God, come before you today with a heart of confession. God, and I pray that it would not merely be seeking to absolve a guilty conscience, but instead, Lord, that our confession, our acknowledgement of our sin would lead us into repentance. That in faith, we would turn away from the false idols of our life and turn towards you, Lord Jesus, that we might go deeper in our relationship with you. In the stillness, God, we come before you as people acknowledging our sin. We're not trying to hide it. We acknowledge it. We come before you confessing openly and honestly. In the stillness, hear our prayer. And God, as we turn from our sin and turn towards you, Lord, you are faithful to forgive. Draw us deeper into your grace and your mercy, that we might be rooted in you, growing day by day to ever greater measure of reflecting your mercy and your grace in the world around us. Lord, we want to be in the light. Continue to shine in us and through us. Lord, in this time, we also lift up to you those in our congregation whom we love so dearly. Lord, I will name a few names, but it's by no means all who are facing struggles and hardships this day. Lord, I lift up to you our sister Annette, our sister Carla, and Sherry. God, be with them on their varying stages of their current treatments, as they are waiting to hear from doctors or waiting to continue in their recovery. God, continue to heal them. We pray for healing in them. Surround them, Lord, we pray. God, I think of the families here in our fellowship this day who recently experienced the loss of a loved one, and in their grief, I pray, God, that you will be present. Draw near to them, that they may sense you with them, and they may know that you are loved, that they are loved by you. God, there are many within our church who have extended family, people who they love facing health issues, uncertainty, some of them who in their own walk with you are far from you, and Lord, I pray not only for healing in their life, but through this time that they would come to know you in a new way. God, and if so, use people within this fellowship to be the ones who bring the gospel to them in a way that they are ready to receive. Holy Spirit, do that work, I pray. And Lord, not only hardship do we acknowledge, but we also celebrate the joys. We mourn with those who mourn, and we rejoice with those who rejoice. And so we rejoice with Sal and Dory as yesterday they became husband and wife. And we just ask, God, that you would surround their marriage, that that would be a marriage that goes deeper in you. May their love for one another be grounded in their love for you. We thank you, God, for them, and we lift them up to you. And finally, God, we acknowledge and we see you as holy. You are set apart. As John writes, you are light in you. There is no darkness. And so, God, you alone are to be praised. You alone are to receive our adoration and our affection for all of eternity. Your grace is truly amazing. And you, above all else, are holy. May the words of our mouth and the expression of our hearts put you where you belong on the throne of our lives. We come before you today proclaiming your goodness. And this we pray in the precious and holy and matchless name of Jesus. Amen.
Would you all stand with me, please, as we sing our closing hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy.
Song shine.
Before we close this morning's service, let's take a moment to reflect on a few things from our series, Gospel-Centered Discipleship. I encourage you to pause the video on the next screen to discuss the following questions with those around you today. Now, if something from today's service is moving on your heart, or if you would like someone to pray with you, please take a moment and reach out to us here at First Covenant Church. Our staff would be honored to hear from you and to pray with you. You can reach out to us by sending us an email or by calling the First Covenant Church office. Now receive these words of benediction from Jude 24 and 25. Now all glory to God, who is able to keep you from falling away and will bring you with great joy into his glorious presence without a single fault. All glory to him who alone is God, our Savior through Jesus Christ our Lord. All glory, majesty, power, and authority are his before all time and in the present and beyond all time. Amen. Now, go into this week learning the gospel, relating in the gospel, and communicating the gospel. Have a great week.